your song. Let's brag on Jesus.
I wish I could tell you, wish I could describe it, but I can't contain it, I can't keep it to myself. There aren't enough colors to paint the whole picture, not enough words to ever say what I found. He's wonderful and beautiful and glorious and holy. He is merciful and powerful.
Who we talking about? That's my King.
Yeah.
We declare glory. We give him all the honor. He's altogether worthy. Who we talking about? That's my King. There's no one before you. Yes, we will adore you. All of this is for you. Who we talking about?
Jesus, you're my King.
You got it, church? Now sing it with us, come on.
I'm not letting the rocks cry without joining the chorus. There aren't enough notes to make the harmony.
It's the song of the angels.
Angels.
The ages.
Angels.
It's all of the earth and heaven symphony.
He is wonderful, come on.
It's wonderful. Altogether worthy. Who we talking about? That's my King. There's no one before you. Yes, we will adore you.
And
all of this is for you. Who we talking about? That's my King.
Amen.
Jesus, yeah.
That's my King. That's my God. That's my Shepherd. My protector, that's my King, that's my rock, that's my anchor,
my defender, that's my King, that's my God, that's my shepherd, my protector, that's my King, that's my rock, that's my
Please take your Bible, have a copy of God's Word, and turn to James chapter 1. And Lord willing, today we will be finished with chapter 1. That's 9 messages into the book. We're getting into the end of chapter 1. James chapter 1, and look down at verse 26. The title of the message this morning is this: The Reality of a Right Religion. The reality of a right religion. James chapter 1, James says, verse 26, he says this: If anyone among you thinks he is religious and does not bridle his tongue, but deceives his own heart, this one's religion is useless. Pure and undefiled religion before God and the Father is this: to visit orphans and widows in their trouble, and to keep oneself unspotted from the world. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word. I pray, Lord, as this week preparing, I pray that we would speak, you would speak to our hearts and we would respond in obedience. Father, this is a lesson, message that's, Father, right in our face with where we live. And Father, I pray that you would speak, that your Holy Spirit would speak to us and change our hearts, our lives, our minds, the way we live for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. The theme of the book of James, as we look at it, James basically says this: if you're a Christian, be a real Christian. If you're a professor in Jesus Christ, you're professing Jesus Christ as your Savior, then be a real professor. Be someone who's the real deal. James tells us what practical Christianity looks like. Living out our Christian life, he goes through several things, talking about living each day, day in, day out, with everyone, every situation, every issue of life. James says, live your faith. Live it out. Make sure it's not just what you say, make sure it's also what you do. James in chapter 1 has encouraged us to run to the Word of God as we deal with everyday issues of life, trials, tribulations, temptations, where we get wisdom, how we understand the truth of life. We got to go to the Bible, run to the Word of God. And James is encouraging because he says this, basically, don't quit. Even though you're going through difficult times in your life, remember, they're going through persecutions. They've been taken, many of them, out of their home country, out of their own land because of their faith. Many of their families have turned their backs on them because they've trusted in Jesus Christ as their Savior. And James, the half-brother of the Lord Jesus Christ, lays it out and says, keep going. Don't stop. Keep going forward. That's why the book of James is a great practical book for us each and every day. No matter where you are in life, it hits you somewhere or another. He's telling the church, I believe, it's time to grow up. Time to be what you profess in Jesus. You say you're a believer? Then let's look at your life, he would say, and let's find out what your life says about what you profess. Applying the Word of God. James was worried about the fact that they were listening to the Word of God, but they were not applying the Word of God to their life. And you and I, listen, we can face that each and every day. We hear the Word. In fact, if you've grown up in church as I have, you've heard a lot of Scripture. You've heard a lot of the Bible. Each week, you go to Sunday school, you go to Bible study, you're doing your devotions, you hear it preached each day, each and every week. But the question is this: not just what did you hear, but what are you doing? Christian lives are important, that we live out practically what we say we believe. Someone said the Christian life is like riding a bicycle. You must keep moving forward. If you don't, you'll fall over. And that's true. A lot of us many times in our Christian walk have settled just to stay where we are. We hear new truth, yet we've sort of settled with what we've done with the old truth. We've lived our life to the best we can. We're trying to be religious, trying to be faithful, trying to be a good Christian. The problem is when that truth comes and God presents that truth to us, are we listening still? So I've been a Christian for 40 years, preacher. Nothing new under the sun, man. No, you don't tell me anything new. No, I don't. But the Bible is always fresh. It's living and it's powerful. There's a difference between a radio in your car and a TV. Radio in your car is nice if you're riding down the road, but you can't see anything, right? Just, there's a reason for that. They don't want you watching TV while you're driving down the road. But listening is great. That's okay, but that's a one-dimensional thing. But you go home, you turn your TV on, now you can see and you can what? And you can hear. The other day, our TV was messed up a little bit. I turned on something, and the TV, the visual was there. I saw what was going on, but I couldn't get the sound going. And I don't know if it's just me or not. I was talking to Brother Jamie today, and same thing. I was showing him something on my phone. No voice, no audio. I'm like, this crazy, you know, it's okay to see it, but I want to hear it too. A lot of Christian life like that. Not only do we need to hear what's going on in our life, we need to see what's going on in our life. And James says that the audio of our profession needs the visual of a life that backs it up. James would say this: don't just tell me what's going on in your life, show me what's going on in your life. James chapter 1, verse 22, he says this: but be doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving yourselves. Don't just hear the word and go on, keep on living the way you've always lived. If you do that, you'll deceive yourself, listen, into believing that you're doing what God wants. Yeah, I hear that, but I'm going to continue to do what I do. See, that's the struggle that we all face in our Christian walk. And James knows that. It was happening back then. It's happening today. That we hear the Word of God, and we look at it, and we acknowledge that it's the Word of God, and we acknowledge that it's true. But when it comes to responding to the Word of God and doing what the Word of God says, many times we pull back and say, well, I'm good. I'm good where I'm at. Everything's fine with what's going on in my life. That will lead to a false type of religion and worship, which I believe is many, in many facets are seen today. James comes to the last verse of chapter 1, and he talks about religion, a true religion versus a false religion. Worthless religion versus a worshipful religion. And James is going to take us right back again to show us how God sees, watch, true, undefiled, or right religion. God sees it in a different way than you and I see it, I guarantee you, because when we get done with today's message, Lord willing, you're going to go, I never thought about that. But God says, just so you understand, Ron, that's the way I see it. And if I want to respond the way God wants me to, I've got to see it, understand it, and obey it how God sees it and how God wants. It's God's viewpoint of the true, undefiled, and right religion. And James lays it out for all of us to see clearly in this passage. Martin Luther made this statement: a religion that gives nothing, costs nothing, and suffers nothing is worth nothing. A lot of that going on today. J. Vernon McGee said this: there is a grave danger of having a religion of the sanctuary, but not a religion of the street. We can all be religious in here. We can all come into the church house and be religious. But what about when I leave this place? What about when I leave for tomorrow? What about when you go to school tomorrow, when you go to work tomorrow, when you're around family and friends? What does your religion look like then? And somebody said, well, you know, I'm not into religion, preacher. This is a relationship to Jesus. It's not religion, and you're exactly right. But a relationship to Jesus will show, watch, pure and undefiled religion as we live it out. And we're going to see that. James lays it out for us very clearly. So the question that James confronts us with today is, do you have a useless or a worthless religion? Do you? I mean, he's going to give us an answer to that, and they're going to help us. He doesn't want to know, hey, how was Brother Ron's sermon today? He wouldn't ask us that. He's not going to say, how was the worship today? That's my king. What a great... He's not going to ask us about that. He's not going to ask us about Sunday school. How was Sunday school class today? How was Bible study? How was your quiet time today? How's your prayer time? No, he's not going to ask us that. What he wants to see is our life that is obedient to what we've learned and what we know. He wants to see our life. He wants to know, James would say this, what are you doing, Ron, with what you've learned? What are you doing with the truth that you know? Are you obeying it? Verse 26, if anyone among you thinks he's religious. Now, listen to me quickly, because sometimes people look at this, I know we as Baptists look at this sometimes, and you say, well, religious, we say things like this, because of the Pharisees and because of what history shows us and all the different types of religions, what we've done is this, we say, well, religion's bad. It's not bad. That's not what he's talking about here. He's not saying it's bad to be religious. Because if you look at verse 27, he says this, pure and undefiled religion before God and his Father is this. So there is a pure religion. There's an undefiled religion. But there's also a useless and a worthless religion. And he contrasts these two. Listen to this closely. Religion rightly lived out is worship to God. If you live out true and undefiled religion before the world, it will be worship to your God. In fact, the word religion goes back to a lot of things. We won't do a long word study today with that, but it talks about worship. Worship. The Bible tells us whether we eat or drink or whatever we do it all for the glory of God. As I minister to other people, as you minister to people around you, as you take care of needs, as you help others, you're doing it, we're going to see in a moment, as you would to Christ. They're doing it as a form of worship to him. The word religious there, threskos, is a word that means this. It means it refers to external rituals, routines, and ceremonies, observances of public worship, such as, we'd say, church attendance, giving, prayer, fasting. Matthew chapter 6 and verse 1 talks about that. It's a Pharisaic element, many forms of the Christian worship. We see false worship. We see false religion. And that's what James is going to contrast here. A.T. Robertson said this, the Jewish historian Josephus used the word religion to describe the worship in the temple. So again, it's a form of that. Paul would use the word in Acts 26, verse 5. He would say this, they knew me from the first, if they were willing to testify that according to the strictest sect of our religion, I lived as a Pharisee. Worship. How's your worship? Verse 26, if anyone among you thinks he's religious. Now watch this. If I was to go around today and say, don't raise your hand, by the way. If I was to go around today and say, yes, all right, how many people in this room think that you are religious? A lot of people, most people, probably everybody, would raise their hand and say, well, you know, I'm pretty religious. And the reason we think we're religious many times is because we have external activities that go on that coincide with what we believe religion does and is. Religious people go to church, don't they? Religious people pray. Religious people read their Bible. Religious people give. Religious people witness. Religious people celebrate at church. We celebrate a moment ago. We're worshiping. I mean, religious people do that, right? That's what everybody thinks today. External observation. We're observing that everybody who does these things must be religious. James says this. Show me evidence of that. I want to see pure and undefiled religion. If you think you're religious just because you do external things, or you think you're religious just because you do these certain things, James contrasts those two and says this, there's a true form of religion, there's a false form of religion. There's true and there's false. There's counterfeit of the true and the real. And so he gives us three things here, and I'm going to give these to you quickly, hopefully. We'll see. Three things that he points out that help us understand the difference between true religion and false religion, true worship and false worship. Now, are you ready for this? Because this is one of those messages that if I was listening to it on the outside, because I already dealt with it in dealing, the preparation of it, it's one of those things I would say this, buckle up. Because James is an in-your-face kind of guy. You understand, James is a guy that he doesn't pull any punches. He doesn't care about your feelings or my feelings. He says, this is truth. And you need, listen, because you're living in trials, temptations, you're living through all these things in life, struggles, trials, good, bad, and different, you need to know the truth. And so James just sort of looks at you. James is not a guy and looks at your life as a snake in your house. He's going to look and go, hey, Ron, there's something long and sort of slithery on the corner over there. No, he's going to look and go, get out, there's a snake over here. And that's what James does in the book of James. So let's first of all notice this. James helps us understand the three points here that we're going to look at of true and right religion. The first point is this. James would say this. Right religion will show up in our conversation. Right religion will show up in our conversation. Again, right religion will be true worship to the Lord. So this is interesting. Verse 26, if anyone among you thinks he's religious, but he does not bridle his tongue. You think you're religious? Yeah, I'm a religious man. I do this, and 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 I got a long list of, you know. It's like the guy the other day we went out to get a burger. And we're standing there, and we're trying to be nice, you know. It's later on at night. We're standing there, and this guy was standing next to us, and he came in after us. And so he said, they said, who's next? And the guy said, oh, they're next. They're next. Go take it down. To which your beloved worship pastor said to this guy, said, oh, no, brother, we're fine. You go ahead. Just one guy there, right? Well, this guy looks, oh, thank you, thank you. And he goes up to the store and goes, I need 25 hamburgers, please. And he went to the hotel. I looked at Jamie and I went, what? No, we didn't do that. I didn't do that. We're just kidding. You can have a long list of everything you do for the Lord. And yet God says, what I need to examine is not the list. What I need to examine is your tongue. What? Wait a minute. That doesn't make sense. Oh, it does to God. See, what we would do is go, look at my list. And God says, I don't need to see your list. I see all that. What I need to see and listen to is what you're saying. Is what you're saying. Many references to believer speech in this letter, in fact, implying that James dealt with the situation back then just like we deal with the situation here. There were problems with speech. There was problem with the tongue. There was problem back then, again, just as it is today. James chapter 2, verse 12. The Bible says this, just give you these. So speak and so do as those who will be judged by the law of liberty. So speak and so do. In other words, what he's saying is this: God's going to hold you accountable for what you say. Everything? Everything. Well, nobody heard that. God heard it. And God's going to hold us accountable for what we say. Why is that? Because what we say comes from the heart. Did you know that? How can he get so upset about just a little thing I said? Because he knows that out of the abundance of the heart, Jesus would say, the mouth speaks. Listen to what he said. He's talking to the Pharisees. He said in Matthew chapter 12, brood of vipers. Wow. How can you, being evil, speak good things? For out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks, Jesus said. A good man out of the good treasure of his heart brings forth good things. And an evil man out of the evil treasure brings forth evil things. But I say to you, this is Jesus, this is the Lord. Listen, but I say to you that for every idle word men may speak, they will give account of it in the day of judgment. By your words you will be justified, and by your words you will be condemned. Wow. So, little brother James hears these things from his brother, the Lord Jesus Christ, and he understands the power of our conversation, the power of our speech. And God says, I'm not worried about what you're doing. I want to hear what you're saying. Now, again, we're going to combine all this in just a little bit, but it's a great picture because you and I would look and say, well, Lord, I've been doing all these things. Remember Matthew 7, verse 21 and following? Many will say to me in that day, didn't we do this and do this and do this and do this? And he said, depart from me, I never knew you. Pull out your list all you want. But James says this, your speech will give you away. Speak and so do, who'll be judged by the law of liberty. Pharisees were very religious, wasn't they? They were very religious. But their worthless religion was evident because their heart was wrong. They had bad hearts. Their words revealed the true condition of their hearts, and their hearts revealed their worship to God. And so the Lord said, brood of vipers, how can you, being evil, speak of good things? Why is that? Because he knew their heart. In another place, he would say this. He would say, their hearts are like, they're like whitewashed tombs. On the outside, they look so good, but on the inside, dead men's bones. Be careful what you say. James chapter 3, verse 1, the Bible says this, my brethren, let not many of you become teachers. And by the way, Lord willing, we're going to try to get to some of these in more depth, but just to give you a brief look at this, let not many of you become teachers, knowing that we receive a stricter judgment. For we all stumble in many things. If anyone does not stumble in word, he is a perfect man, able to also bridle the whole body. There's that word again. Indeed, we put bits in horses' mouths that they may obey us. We turn their whole body. Look also at ships. Although they are so large and driven by fierce winds, they are turned by a very small rudder wherever the pilot desires. Even so, the tongue is a little member, and boasts great things. See how great a forest a little fire kindles, and the tongue is a fire of world in a world of iniquity. The tongue is also so set among our members that it defiles the whole body and sets on fire the course of nature and is set on fire by hell. For every kind of beast and bird, a reptile and creature of the sea is tamed and has been tamed by mankind. But no man can tame the tongue. It is an unruly evil, full of deadly poison. With it we, listen to this, with it we bless our God and Father, and with it we curse men who have been made in the similitude or the likeness of God. He says this in verse 10, out of the same mouth proceed blessing and cursing. My brethren, these things ought not be so. Does a spring send forth fresh water and bitter from the same opening? Can a fig tree, my brethren, bear olives, or a grapevine bear figs? Thus no spring yields both salt water and fresh. Pretty clear, isn't it? He's pretty focused. A person comes to church, they praise the Lord 1 minute, and they leave here cursing the next. Your worship, your religion is worthless. hateful to your spouse at home but treat others better than you treat her here in the sanctuary, your religion is worthless. Children disobey their parent, backtalk their parent all week long, try to be holy on Sunday, gossiping on the phone on Saturday night, singing praises to the King on Sunday morning. Something not right. Somebody said, well, you know, I don't gossip. I just encourage people to pray for people. You ever heard somebody say that? I'm not gossiping. I'm just saying we need to pray for them. But did I tell you what they did? I heard a guy say one time, the difference between gossip and a concerned friend is like the difference between a butcher and a surgeon. Both cut meat, but for totally different reasons. That's true. You've got a gossipy tongue during the week, and you try to sing praises on Sunday, it's evidence of some problems going on in your life. If your religion, your worship hasn't changed your tongue, it's evidence that it is useless, worthless religion. And I'd say it, James said that. That's the great part about preaching on James. James says some things I wish I could. I'd get in trouble if I said it, so no. James chapter 1, verse 26, again, if anyone among you thinks he's religious and does not bridle his tongue, but deceives his own heart, this one's religion is useless. Bridle, the word bridle there, you know what a bridle is. It's a little thing that controls the way the horse goes. On a horse, if you've ever ridden a horse, you understand, you'd pull this way, the horse goes this way. You pull back this way, the horse stops. Pull this way, and the horse goes this way. You lead the horse by the bridle. I believe the Word of God and the Spirit of God should be our bridle. I believe we understand the Word of God and the Holy Spirit of God leading us and guiding us. But listen, many times in our life, God says, whoa! And you know what we do? We just keep going. God says, go this way. And we go, yeah, I think I'll go this way. God says, go this way. And we say, nah, I think I'll go this way. God says, forgive. Nah, I don't think I'll do that right now. We get bitter. God says, be kind. No, I don't think so. And we let ourselves, our own heart, the wickedness of our heart, lead us and guide us. A lot of tongues today are not bridled, are they? Don't talk about how you worship God again on Sunday if you're out of control, your tongue's out of control on Monday. James chapter 3, verse 14 says this, if you have bitter envy and self-seeking in your hearts, listen, do not boast and lie against the truth. This wisdom does not descend from above, but is earthly, sensual, and demonic. Wow. So he links a lot that goes on to trouble that we have in our life based on our heart and our tongue and our worship. James chapter 4, verse 11 says this, do not speak evil to one another, brethren. He who speaks evil of a brother and judges his brother speaks evil and of the law and judges the law. But if you judge the law, you are not a doer of the law, but a judge. There is one lawgiver who is able to save and to destroy. And then he asks the question, who are you to judge another? Boy, we're right in the middle of that, aren't we? You ever speak evil of another? How many times this week do you speak evil of another? He who speaks evil of a brother and judges his brother speaks evil of the law and judges the law. Why is that? Why is that? Because God's the judge, not you. His holy word is the judge, not us. And we look at that and we go, yeah, I know the Bible says that, but did you see what he did? And before long, we just blasted and doing all the things with our tongue. Why is that? Because our hearts are not right. It's the tongue that reveals the heart. And if the heart is right, listen, the speech will be right. Controlled tongue means a controlled body, and out of control tongue means an out of control body. It's just that simple. So James says, you want evidence of a right religion? It'll be in your conversation. It'll show up in your conversation. Number two, right religion will show up in our compassion. Not just our conversation, but it'll show up in our compassion. Look at verse 27. He says, pure and undefiled religion before God and the Father is this, to visit orphans and widows in their trouble. After we've seen ourselves in the mirror of the Word of God and who we are and deal with that, then we've got to deal with others around us who have needs. We're living in a day and time when that's taken a back seat in a lot of ways. And it has for many years in the body of Christ. You remember Isaiah in Isaiah chapter 6. And we won't go into a lot of this, but Isaiah saw the Lord Then he saw himself, and then he saw others. And it works that way, did you know? When you spend time with God, you get in the presence of God, you see the Lord for who he is, and then you see yourself for who you are, and then all of a sudden now you can see the need in other people's lives, because it's not all about you anymore. It's not all about me. Isaiah would say this, I saw the Lord. And then he would say this, after he saw the Lord and just got in his presence, he would say, woe is me, for I am undone. I'm undone. And then he says this, because I'm a man of unclean lips and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips, for my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. Then one of the seraphim flew to me, having in his hand a live coal, which he had taken with the tongs from the altar. And he touched my mouth with it and said, behold, this has touched your lips. Your iniquity is taken away and your sin is purged. Then verse 8, also I heard the voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send and who will go for us? Notice he didn't ask that question until he came in his presence and he dealt with him his sin. And once he had dealt with his sin before God and God had cleansed him, now God says, now I need somebody. And Isaiah says, here I am, send me. He's not saying that before he meets with the Lord. He's not saying that before his sins are forgiven. But once he gets in the presence of God and once his sins are purged, then he says, I'm your guy. I'm your guy. And listen, all through the Bible, Old and New Testament, we see that process. So true and pure religion, worship, will show up in our compassion. I love what James says. Pure and undefiled religion before God and the Father is this. And he says this, to visit orphans and widows in their trouble. Now, you and I, sometimes we look at that and we go, not that, we look at our life and go, well, I've done this and I do this and I do this and I do this. I do all these things for the Lord. But he looks at something different here. Our tongue has to be under control. Then true religion, true worship, we'll find is not selfish. What you find in your life is this, that many times you can see your Christian walk and you'll see times of selfishness, can't you? Because all of a sudden it's all about me. This is what I want. This is what I believe. This is what I feel. This is what I deserve. This is my rights. And before long, we've stepped out of walking in the Spirit of God and the Word of God, and now we've gone back to the worldly side to say it's all about me. It's all about me. It's all about me. It's a false religion that says this, I'll do for you if you do for me. The problem is today that in the body of Christ, that can slip into our way of thinking. Well, I'll do this because they can do this for me. And I'll help them because they can do this for me. And before long, we get out of focus. That's a business deal. That's not religion. And notice what he says here. He says the orphans and widows. Now, why does he say that? Well, one of the things we know from that term, he uses orphans and widows, that these were the most helpless people in the day. The economy of the Jews, these people were the poorest of the poor. These were women who did not have husbands to take care of them. These are children, they didn't have parents to take care of them. You know, and we have all the different things set up now to take care of a lot of things, but back then they didn't. I mean, they just had to beg, they had to go into all kinds of bad situations. And this is the picture, again, for the body of Christ. James is saying, look, I know you're all scattered. I know you got all this going on, everything around you. It's just, but don't forget, you got to meet the needs of those around you. And can I tell you for a moment, that's why the New Testament church grew like it did. That's one of the reasons. I mean, the power of God, the Spirit of God fell. I mean, and it was just, but what they did was they started reaching people, listen, that nobody was reaching. They started ministering to people that nobody was ministering to. I heard someone say a long time ago, you've heard me say it before. Someone said, if you want to have the church that everybody wants, reach the people that nobody wants. You go out and meet needs, you go out and reach needs, you go out and meet people's needs and don't expect anything in return, and it lines up with the compassion, I believe, that James is talking about here. True and right religion always works itself out to help others, to do for others who can't do for you in return. See, we've got to be careful of this American dream. We can let that slip into our Christianity. And what we need to find out, again, what we've done is this. What we've said as the church now, we've said, we've got institutions for this. We've got government for this. We've got things. We've all these different things that do that. We don't have to do it anymore. The government does it. Can I tell you, I don't want to relate the government to anything in my Christian life. Much less trust them to fulfill what I'm supposed to be fulfilling as the body of Christ. Can't do that. So yet we've done that. Why is it important? To take care of needs of people that can't help us back in return. I think it's because that's exactly what our Heavenly Father did. Remember Romans 5:8? But God demonstrated, listen, His own love toward us, in that while we were yet, what, sinners, Christ died for us. God didn't look and say, well, let's see how you do first. Let's see, I'm going to see how you do before I die on the cross. Let's just do, no. He demonstrated His love toward us, and that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. When the church today, what the church today has done is, again, we've turned over our responsibility to others. And we talk more about that when we get to James chapter 2. But if you look around, well, we do this, we do this, we have committees to do this, we have government agencies to do this, we have people that can do this. Just send them there. Send them there. We'll let them do the work when God has engifted each and every one of us to do the work. We'll talk about that. James chapter 2, verse 14. He says this, "What does it profit, my brethren, if someone says he has faith but does not have works? Can faith save him? If a brother or sister is naked and destitute of daily food, and one of you says to them, 'Depart in peace, be warmed and filled,' but you do not give them the things which are needed for the body, what does it profit?" And then James will reiterate it by saying, "Thus also faith by itself, if it does not have works, is dead." What use is religion if it doesn't help a person in need? When you have the resources to help someone and you don't, what's James saying? I think he's telling us, if your tongue, if your conversation is not matching up, then it's false. It's just fake. It's just fake faith. If your compassion is just limited to some and not to those in, it's fake. It's fake faith. 1 John chapter 3, verse 16. "By this we know love, because he laid down his life for us, and we also ought to lay down our lives for the brethren. But whoever has this world's goods and sees his brothers in need and shuts up his," listen, "his heart from him," see that word? "How does the love of God abide in him?" What a rhetorical question. Are you kidding me? If you say this and you don't do this, you think God living in there? "Thus also faith by itself, if it does not have works, is dead." The quality of your ministry and mine will be tied to the people that we minister to that can do nothing for us in return. But yet, a lot of the time, we don't think that, do we? That's not something we would have put on the list. Because we think, watch, Lord, I got a list here. It's a pretty good list. I do this, and I give this, and I give this. And God says, yeah, but you got a neighbor. You got that guy I brought in. What about this? What about this situation? What about that person? Well, yeah, I sent them to the church. Yeah, but I gave you the resources to help them at that point. And yet you shoved them off on somebody else. Can I just tell you, that happens a lot today. Not only in everybody, it happens in all our lives. We've got to be careful to have true, undefiled religion and worship. Jesus would use that term in Matthew 25. Look it up later. When he would talk to the people, Jesus would say, "You know what? Sheep and the goats," he'd start talking about them. He said, "You know, enter in. When I was hungry, you fed me. When I was naked, you clothed me. When I was in need," and they're going to look at him in the judgment time and go, "Lord, when did we see you that way?" He said, "When you did it to the least of these, you did it to me." See, you can't get away from it. And James, I love how James does it, because he takes sort of the whole picture of Scripture and he lays it down and says, your conversation will give you away, or your conversation will show you it's true. Your compassion will give you away, or to show that your faith is true. And again, you can look up the Good Samaritan, Luke chapter 10. Let me give you the last one here. The last one is here. Not only right religion will be shown up in our conversation, show up in our compassion, but look what James says here in the verse 27. Right religion will show up in our conduct. In our conduct. Look what he says. "Pure and undefiled religion before God and the Father is this, to visit orphans and widows in their time of trouble," watch, "and to keep oneself unspotted from the world." Unspotted from the world. Now, what does that mean? When James talks about the world, he's talking about a society, a culture, an environment that is without God, that is against God. The Bible tells us that Satan is the prince of this world, the Bible tells us in John 14. The lost are the children of the world, the Bible tells us in Luke 16. And as the children of God, we are to be in the world physically, but we're not to be of the world spiritually, John 17, 11 and following. And so what we find is this: as the children of God, we are to maintain separation from the world by the same time ministering to the world. You say, that's pretty difficult. No, Jesus did that. You say, well, that's Jesus. Yeah, but that same Jesus lives in you. Right? Amen? I had to go back to some doctrine of salvation. Yeah, he lives in you, right? Holy Spirit of God lives in you. And you drive my job to get what? Get ourselves out of the way and let Christ live through us. But only as we maintain our separation from the world can we do these things of ministering and encouraging people. But our lives, listen, God doesn't mind you being in the world. God wants you. God created the world. He created the world for us. But he does not want us to be of the world. Of the world. Because the definition of worldliness is to leave God out, to oppose God. And the Bible talks about, again, a society without God, excluding God in our life. Romans 1 tells us that the people in those days worshiped and served the creature more than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. Right? And what we do today, a lot of times, is this: we worship and serve the blessing more than the blesser. You say, how's that happen? Well, we're to be unspotted from the world. What does it mean to be spot? What does that mean? The word world is cosmos. It means it's used of arranging. It's the word that we get our word cosmetics from. And we always like to make this point, you know, when a lady is putting on her makeup, she's arranging things. Right? Nothing bad about that. I'm not getting all that. But that's what she's doing. She's arranging things on her face. But there's an arrangement in this world that is anti-God. There's a system in this world, there's an arrangement of this world that leaves God out. And we are to be unspotted by this world that is arranged that way. You say, well, how does that happen? It happens very quickly. First of all, there's friendship with the world, James chapter 4, verse 4. You say, well, friendship, man, I got a lot of friends of people who are not Christians that don't know the Lord. I agree, I've got it too. But friendship with the world is different. When I become friendship with the world, I become friendship with the anti-God system. And I'm allowing that to be a part of my life. It doesn't mean lost friends. It doesn't mean people who don't know Jesus. Jesus, all the time, he would be around people. They gave him grief because he hung around the sinners, the prostitutes, the tax collectors. They hated him because of it. But he did not, again, adhere to that and conform to the world, the anti-God system. He dealt with the ministry. He dealt with people. But he was not spotted by the world. There's friendship with the world. Then there's love of the world. John, 1 John chapter 2. And if you're not careful, you can become conformed to the world. Romans chapter 12, verse 1 and 2. And the result of being conformed to the world, we'd be condemned with the world. Not to lose your salvation, but to lose the things that you have. Lot is a great example of that in the Bible. Lot in the Bible set his... He looked towards Sodom, and he focused on Sodom. And then he moved to Sodom. And then before long, as someone said, everyone preached, and then all of a sudden, Sodom moved into him. And see, that's what happens when our focus is not the Lord. The best way to minister to the needs of the world is to be pure from the defilement of the world. The world wants us defiled. The world wants a spot upon us. Because that's what people look at, don't they? When we joke about this a lot, but you go out to eat, if you have a tie on, you go out to eat, a lot of times you can get cheese dip on your tie. And I don't know, it just bothers me sometimes I get cheese dip on my tie. But here's the thing, when I get cheese dip on my tie, that's all I focus on. Somebody look, you can sit next to somebody who has a suit on, a tie on, something like that, and look at you and go, hey, you got something on your tie right there. Well, what about the rest? The rest looks pretty good, huh? They ain't worried about that. They worry about the spot. And that's what the world does. That's right. If our conduct, our behavior has areas where we look like the world, And then you're like Lot, you try to go witness to somebody, say, judgment's coming. They're going to look and go, yeah, but look at the spot in your life. Look what's going on with you. Look what you've done. Look at, and before long, they're picking out the spots. And so James very clearly says, you want to see your faith? You want to see your worship? You want to see your true religion? Let's listen to what you say. Let's watch who you minister to, if you do. And let's look at your life. And let's just see if your life lines up with what you're saying. I'm going to close. Someone said, I heard this illustration years ago, he said that sometimes we can, it's like a wedding. Weddings are interesting, you know, and I do a lot of weddings. I've done a lot of weddings through the years. They use this illustration I thought was good. They said this. You know, sometimes if you look at a husband and wife, you know, the couple, they're getting up here to get married. And if the wife looks over and you say, do you take this man to be your husband? And she looks and says, did you see the ring he got me? It's a nice ring. It's a big rock. And the pastor says, yeah, I know, yeah, I get that, but do you take him to be your husband? I take his ring. That's what I want. Yeah, but will you love him? Will you honor him? Will you do? Take care of that. I'm going to get that insured. Yeah, I got the ring part. The ring is just what he gave you. Now, listen, what I need to know is this. Will you take him? Does he come with the ring? Yeah. And before long, the focus becomes what he gave her instead of him. And I got thinking, I thought, you know, that's really the Christian life sometimes. Sometimes we look at the blessings of God and we say, I take all the stuff God's done for me. I take all the things he's given me. But what about, God says, what about me? Yeah. I know you come along with it, but I want all this. And we're so involved in the world that we forget the one who gave it all. Jesus gave it all. All to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. Watch, he washed it white as snow. Amen. Isn't it great to know? Amen. The God loves you so much that he's done so much. He never intended for the things that he gave us to be our God. He never intended for the things of the world that are anti him to be our focus. And James pulls back and he says, true and undefiled religion before God and the Father is this. And he talks about it and how to live our life for the glory of God. And he says, look, right religion will show up in your conversation. Right religion will show up in your compassion. It just will. It'll be an overflow into someone else's life of what's going on. Watch this, of the heart. And see, it all goes back to the heart, doesn't it? Because my conversation, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. Out of the abundance of love for God and for others, I'm going to have compassion out of my abundance of my heart. And then, out of my love for him and putting him first and foremost in my life, you know what? My conduct's going to be right because my heart's right. That's a great picture for all of us as we leave here today to go, you know, I want to be God's man. I want to be God's woman. I want to be God's young person, make a difference for God. But to do that, how's your speech? How's your service? How's your separation from the world? And lay that out, and before the Lord, just deal with that. Would you bow with me? Time of commitment. Time of challenge right here. In your heart of hearts, you're here today, and you're a Christian. Let's start with a Christian. You're the Christian. You're focused. You're a believer. My question to you would be the same question James would ask is this. Are you living the life? Are you walking your faith? Does your walk match your talk? And if you say, yeah, then let's just examine as he would. How's your speech? How's your speech? Now, we won't get into this right now because I don't have time. But this means social media too, just so you know. We'll get into that, Lord willing. I didn't say that. No, you typed it, and it went out for 5 million people to see. We could talk about that, couldn't we? How's your speech? How's your compassion? Are you serving? Are you ministering? Is God using you to make a difference in people's lives that can't help you? Are you sensitive to the leadership of the Holy Spirit of God that puts people in your path that says, these are people that need help? And by helping them physically and speaking to them verbally and living your life before them holy, maybe, just maybe, the Holy Spirit of God's using that to draw them to faith in Christ. Maybe you're here today and you say, Pastor, I'm not a Christian. I've never trusted Christ. Well, you're here on the right day. I'm just telling you. Because if God the Holy Spirit is dealing with your heart, and you'll turn to Jesus Christ by faith and repent of your sins and say yes to Christ, He'll forgive you today and make you, again, a child of God. He'll be Lord of your life. Would you trust Him today? Would you call upon His name? Oh, God, I'm a sinner. Oh, God, forgive me. I believe You died on a cross. I believe You rose again. And I believe You forgive me because I take You at Your word. Right where you sit, right there, you can trust Christ as your Savior. Call upon His name and ask Him to come into your life to forgive you of your sins. He'll save you. He loves us that much. Demonstrated before you were even born by dying on a cross. Whatever you need this morning, the altar's open. You may want to come and pray. Father, I thank You for our time together. Strengthen us, Lord, in Your word and through Your Spirit. And Father, wow, what a powerful passage just in two verses that helps us understand the importance of our heart and our worship and our religion to live for You and to give You glory. I pray for those who need to be saved, that You draw them to faith. I pray for those, Lord, who are Christians that are dealing with their conversation, they're dealing with their compassion, they're dealing with their conduct. I pray that the Holy Spirit of God would just reveal, and that, Father, they would not just walk away here going, yeah, okay, great, but they would, Father, deal with those issues in their heart and just be cleansed, repent, and turn to You. Is there anyone here today who doesn't has some questions, doesn't know about trusting Christ? We'd love to help them. Father, open their hearts. And if there's anyone here today who, again, needs to be a part of our church family, Lord, give them the boldness to come. Father, we thank You for this time. We ask You bless this invitation in Jesus' name. Amen.